you know, in speaking to my peers and you know, friends, I got the sense that everyone felt like there's something wrong with social media. There's a kind of disturbing feeling that what it's doing to our personal lives, to our social relationships, and to society at large is kind of upsetting, and it's doing things that are contrary to values that we care about and how we want to structure our lives. And so I really had two aims in writing this book. One was to distill and present what I call the painful truths around social media. And by this I mean truths insofar as there's a kind of emerging consensus among a growing body of experts and scholars around kind of the pathologies of social media, some of the negative externalities that are beginning to mount. Scientific studies are accumulating, showing that there are lots of unintended and very negative consequences to many aspects of social media. At the heart of the business model of social media is something that the companies themselves don't often forthrightly describe to us. No matter how they advertise their products, connecting friends and families, wiring the world, putting information at our fingertips and doing all sorts of entertaining, convenient things, all social media applications have one overarching imperative, and that is to gather as much information as they can from their users of their products and services in order to monetize that information, either by advertising to them directly or by taking the data that they collect and selling it to third parties, whether those are data brokers, location trackers, other data analytics companies and advertising firms, and even increasingly government agencies. Our social media consumption patterns and habits leaves a huge ecological footprint, ranging from the mining and manufacturing of all of the components and rare earth minerals that go into our devices and peripherals and equipment that we use, to the huge energy consumption at the center of it all. Right now, what we're all doing collectively, out of necessity, mind you, because of the pandemic, is a massive energy consumption draw. Now, it may be the case that some of the energy we're using is powered by sustainable forms of energy, but the sad reality is that in most of the global south, the countries that are experiencing rapid upticks in social media usage also happen to be the places where fossil fuel consumption still predominates. So what I do at the end of Reset is make a plea for a single overarching principle to help guide us as to what to do to repair and mitigate some of these problems around social media. And that principle is restraint. Now, most people, I think, are familiar with the common sense meaning of the term restraint. It means to hold something down or to temper some kind of emotional reaction, personally speaking. What many people might not be familiar with is that the principle of restraint is embedded in a long tradition of theorizing about security and about liberty that goes all the way back to ancient Greece, that is typically associated with that family of theorizing that we know as liberal republican theorizing. Now, at the heart of this body of political philosophy is the idea that, and the recognition that human beings are flawed in significant ways. They tend to have lapses in judgment. They tend to be prone to greediness and corruption. And that in designing our political systems, we need to factor that in. And the best way to prevent the abuse of power is by having various restraint mechanisms applied to any large organizations that have a lot of power. And so what I do at the end of the book is talk about what some of those restraint mechanisms might look like in the context of our technological ecosystem that we live in, applied to governments, private sector, and also civil society and to ourselves. And here I think it's very interesting because, as Josh mentioned, the notion of antitrust, for example, is very much at the heart of liberal Republican thinking. At the core of this idea is big is bad. The concentration of power leads to abuses of power, not just in terms of economic competitiveness, but for society as a whole. And so we need to make sure that organizations, whether they're governments or companies, don't centralize and consolidate power too much that it prevents a threat to society.
The next question, this got 16 upvotes. Should encryption of social media and messaging platforms be regulated? What are your thoughts on encryption and messaging platforms, Ron?
Well, I think encryption is actually a very important technological restraint. I talked about the importance of thinking of various restraint mechanisms, and here is one where technology can provide something of value when it comes to protecting users and citizens' liberty and security. We need to be able to have means to speak to each other, to share information in strict confidence. That's essential to a liberal democratic society. Now, does that create inconveniences for, say, law enforcement? Absolutely. It makes their job tougher than it was 20 years ago when they could simply walk into the telecommunications companies and say, hey, do you mind if we just listen in on this conversation? We've got a judge's warrant here. Now they're saying, oh my gosh, encryption is putting us in the dark. Not surprisingly, a lot of nasty people are going to use end-to-end encryption to do all sorts of malicious things. And as I said, law enforcement is going to have some tricky challenges doing the type of investigations that they do. However, we need to understand the context here. We live in a world where our lives have been turned inside out, where there is this enormous data sphere that exists separate from us, where an individual's movements, preferences, social relationships, habits can be tracked with a precision that's unprecedented in human history. Law enforcement needs to adapt. Frankly, they're living in the golden age of intelligence gathering. So I don't have much sympathy for this idea of weakening encryption because their job is more difficult. That's effectively weakening all of society for one special interest, as important as that is. Police have to adapt. Intelligence agencies have to adapt. And like I said, I frankly believe they have a wealth of information at their fingertips now. So weakening encryption is a very bad idea.